So Ant-Man and the Wasp, pretty damn good. I didn't have an opening gag, so I just figured.
That's a good place to start.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Before we get onto the nonsense, I'm Connor McGraw. Welcome to Phantom Zone. This is our review of Ant-Man and the Wasp. Who else is here?
Arlen Haro, as usual.
I'm Alan Mirio.
I'm John Sieler, and I survived AX.
And I'm Luis, and this was a movie where this guy Scott, he did this thing, and he met this guy, and he had this suit and a trunk, and then he grew really tall.
Oh,
and
man.
Other guys. It was really cool, and then he got to drive this really fast car, and it was kind of like Tokyo Drift, but then it shrunk and it grew.
That's a pretty dead-on impression.
Yeah, yeah. And Lou's the only one here who can do it.
Yep.
Well, my name is actually Luis, so it works well.
Yeah, yeah.
So, better or worse than Ant-Man 1?
Better.
But I agree.
Equal.
Yeah. Equal. Yeah.
I would say, like, this, I would give it the same as, like, my Guardians to Guardians 2. Like, depending on my mood, they're equal.
Me going into this, my big thing was I really wanted to see how they did Wasp. Not only did I really enjoy her, but Ghost is cool as shit, too.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And she's compelling.
Yeah.
Be sympathetic.
And I think
she's not really even a villain. She's an antagonist, which is interesting for a Marvel movie.
I think that's like the only villain in that movie is the Walton Boggs character.
Yeah, and even he's like he's a light villain.
He's a sleazeball, but he's not a city destroying alien or monster.
He's a foil.
Yeah, he's Kirk Barrett, basically.
Justin Hammer,
Army Hammer.
Which is like kind of like why like the first Ant-Man movie was like successful when it came out, because it was like after this huge Age of Ultron movie, and then you know this movie comes after you know Infinity War, which just ramped up the stakes more, and it's like you know like let's just have something a little bit not as dire. And it works very well because of that.
I really like the idea that this whole movie's plot depends on the fallout from Civil War. Because most of like the little tiny conflicts have to do with Steve being in his house when he's supposed to because he's under house arrest.
Mm-hmm. Scott, you mean? But yeah.
Scott. Oh, yeah. Did I say Steve?
Yeah, you said Steve. It's...
What the fuck?
Scott, hey, it's close. But it's all of it has to do with like our laws. Are the laws just? Are they right? And if it's an unjust law, should you break it? Which is a theme in movies of the summer with superheroes.
Like he ditched the two of them to just run off and play superhero.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, like completely abandoned his relationship with Hope.
Yeah, and she does bring up a good point. If she went with him, they wouldn't have gotten caught.
Mm-hmm.
I do love the fact that she's the badass. And he's like kind
he's
of.
He's an oaf, and I love it.
Mm-hmm. And he's not just better at it than him, she's also smarter than him. Like, he's an oaf. He has one skill, which is like breaking into places.
Which was like kind of like my big thing about. That was like my hang up about the first Ant-Man movie was that it was like this ongoing joke about how Hope was the better hero than Scott Lang. But like they had this really stupid contrived reason like why they couldn't let Hope be, you know, the hero of the movie, and that's why I like this way more, because it's like, oh, we get to finally see her be awesome, and it was great.
And the movie wastes no time in basically giving quips about that very idea, because as soon as she shows up, like she has wings, she has all kinds of extra weapons, and Scott likes what that. Scott's like, what the hell? She has blasters.
He's like, wait, did you not have this like for my suit? And he's like,
no, I did.
My favorite parts of the movie though are Michael Douglas being, can you stop thinking about my daughter and go do the thing?
Yeah, that was pretty good.
Michael Douglas was peak grouchy in this movie. I loved it. He has this look like he's constantly tired of everybody's shit.
It's pretty great.
And this movie kind of does like a thing that I think Marvel has had kind of like a hard time doing for like the last 35 years of Hank Pym, and make him like tolerable.
Oh, the damage control is real in this. He's a grouch, and he's kind of like he's a professional asshole. but I don't think people are really ever going to get over like the two occasions of Hank Pym backhanding Janet across the face.
Well, don't forget the Ultimates where he sprays her with bug spray.
Yeah. And not to like completely like kind of like knock away like the things that Hank Pym does in the movie. Like there's some like instances in the movie where especially like Bill Foster talking about like some stuff that happens later on in the movie where Hank just pushes away everyone. I thought that was going to kind of play like a little bit bigger of a part, and it kind of doesn't. And that's like my only like weak point in the story where I thought there was going to be like this real good comeuppance for Hank that never kind of comes up.
Well, I think
no, in fact, it's quite the opposite. Like he gets the one thing he's wanted for a long time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think it more speaks to like, that's the kind of shittiness of him in this universe. Cause if in the kind of canon, him and Howard Stark are contemporaries ish.
Yes, and in I believe in the first one, like isn't the first scene Pym storming off because he doesn't want Pym particles used in weaponry?
He's slightly, I would say he's like 20 years, maybe 15, 20 years younger than Howard, but he's definitely much older than Tony. But yeah, so he's kind of in this older version of like a tech billionaire. So I like thinking of him like Tony Stark. 20 years from now, just being like, everyone's dumber than me. Stop with your dumb ideas. Like,
yeah.
I'm the smartest man in the room.
The thing is, most of the time he is, so...
Yeah, I do like the fact that Ghost is also kind of like the shield... She's like the inverted shield version of Bucky.
Yeah.
I love Ghost. I never connected those two dots.
Yeah, it's she's basically she's basically a covert op for S.H.I.E.L.D. In the same way that like the Winter Soldier was, you know, a covert op for Hydra.
Or Eric.
Widow, like assassin that they use. Although Black Widow's more of like espionage where she's just a straight up assassin.
Well, right. Yeah, you can do a whole lot more with Ghost than you can do with Black Widow because Ghost can walk through literally any front door in the world.
Yeah, she's a one-woman hit squad.
Yeah. But that costume is cool as shit, too. I love the color on it. The mask is really cool. I like the fact that it was so bright and kind of simplified.
But it was very, like, not techy, but it looked... it reminded me... I can't remember. It's like Splinter Cell, like the kind of headpiece. Like the
The multiple night vision thingamajigs.
Yeah. Like, it was just an interesting style. I loved that it was white and gray.
Yeah, I also, that thing she does with Hank when she, like, phases her hand through his neck and threatens to basically solidify. I'm like, that's a real nasty way to go.
Because she straight up reverse flashes, like, the other guy later on. And
I know, it was awesome.
He's like, you're not going to vibrate your hand through my chest or whatever.
Some of the jokes this movie were good, but they're... I don't want to say weird, but like the joke where they're all in disguises and Scott is like, these aren't disguises. We're just dressed up as us.
So we look like
I'm like, are you guys finally commentating on the fact that you guys never dress these characters up in proper disguises? It's just like Cap goes out with a hoodie and some glasses and he calls it a day.
Right.
It's the exact outfit that Cap is wearing. Was that in Civil War or Winter Soldier?
Winter Soldier and Civil War. Like he did both. Yeah, it's interesting because Paul Rudd was one of the writers on this movie.
Yeah.
I think that's where that comes from.
Oh, good.
I do want to say,
evidently, he was also a writer on the first one.
Yeah, yeah.
I do want to say, every Marvel movie, this is the first one where I actually remember a child actor, and the girl just kills it.
Like, dude, Scott's daughter's the best.
Yeah, she's the best, and I also like. There was, like, moments where Cassie is just like, oh, I want to be your partner, and, like, I want to help you fight crime, and I'm, like, thinking about it, I'm like, oh, my God, are they, like, seriously, like, planting the seeds for Young Avengers so Cassie becomes Stature?
That was actually a headline I saw, that the MCU, it was MCU planning on using Stature.
Yeah, I thought they even, like, sort of cast, like, an older version of her at one point.
Yeah, like, this movie actually sets up, like, a lot of just, like, seeds, like, that that Ghost can go on and maybe go and do something and be part of something later, that Cassie could be a part of something later. Like,
yeah.
It's like, oh, we might, it honestly might be like one of those things that they don't go to or back to for like a little bit, but it's like the seeds are planted.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Lou, were you gonna say something?
I was gonna say, it's when Marvel's doing good stuff with villains or like characters in general, is that they leave stuff that they can be picked up later, or they just don't cut things off, which they did kind of in phase one a lot, where they just like killed people off, like first Ant-Man. But
yeah,
let's be real, nobody was missing Yellow Jacket the moment he left.
Yeah,
well, yeah.
Even I think Peyton Reed was like, yeah, I didn't like Yellow Jacket either, and I wasn't too happy about using him, but oh well.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was Patrick Wilson initially, and then Edgar Wright left. So,
yeah. So they got Corey Stahl?
Yep. Discount Patrick Wilson.
What a weird
Corey
replacement.
Is Patrick Wilson the guy that's playing Jason Momoa's brother in Aquaman?
Yeah, he's Night Owl.
Yeah. And he's Ed Warren.
Yeah, Ed
Warren. What was I going to say? Oh, I almost bet money Ghost will be in Infinity War Part 2 or whatever they're going to call it. I'm very close.
I think they said it's Endgame.
Yeah, the more we're getting close to it, the more I think it's Endgame.
I think it got...
I'm inclined to believe it. We'll know, because apparently we'll get an ad for it after the first Captain Marvel ad runs. So
yeah. We'll see. Something else I liked about this was actually a weird Iron Man 2 connection, because this movie's connective tissue was very strong. And the Goliath Project is actually talked about all the way back in Iron Man 2, because when when Tony's trying to create the new element, he's like, get me everything on Project Pegasus, Goliath, and... Oh, shit, I can't remember what the other one was.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
No, I don't remember. I have to watch that.
Mm-hmm.
I barely remember that movie.
Iron Man 2 had like a ton of like Easter eggs during all that sequences.
There
was stuff about Cap in it. There was stuff about Atlantis.
I mean, they set up Wakanda. Yeah.
Well, that's what the big thing that people kind of railed against Iron Man 2 was because it was too much Avengers setup and not much else.
Mm-hmm.
Which I tend to disagree with.
I think it's fair.
I mean, like, I haven't seen Iron Man 2 in a very long time, but, like, it was, like, it wasn't just, like, the Avengers stuff, but it was just, like, the A-plot was also just, like, not very good, because it was just, like, oh, hey, we're doing Demon in a Bottle, I guess. Which, you know, prior to 2001 was the most well-known Iron Man story.
Right.
Yeah.
The thing is, before the first Iron Man wasn't really a super A-lister like he is now.
True.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, when the best part of your movie is my bird, then
where's
you know
my
your
beard?
Movie's bad.
I want my beard.
Where's my bird? I need my bird.
Mickey Rourke, it like sucks in that movie too.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like
and he's one of the best parts.
Yeah.
Somebody really loved Mickey Rourke and just gave him no direction and was just like, do you?
Mm-hmm.
More or less.
I think I've heard that like the whole bird thing was like all him.
It was. Past that monologue in the prison scene, it's just all improv, probably. I would bet.
This is before we learned about CTE, because Mickey Rourke did a professional boxer at some point before all this.
Oh, yeah, it's why he looks the way he does now, is because he got his face mangled. Yeah. But I lost my train. Oh, yeah, actually, with Iron Man 2, like, fucking Whiplash just devolving into, like, look, I got a suit, too.
Whiplash is like a prime example of like how poor Iron Man's rogues gallery is.
Oh yeah, well, because doesn't it just boil down to like other people in suits?
Yeah, that's it's all like here's a Russian guy in a suit. Here's like an air guy in a suit.
There's like five Stiltmans, which is what
Yo dog, don't be talking mess about Stiltman.
Well, the character from Netflix, the Turk. Turk is one of the Stiltmen.
Oh my god, what? That's awesome.
So wait, there could be a battle of the Stiltmen on the Netflix universe. That's great.
Give it to me.
And the one that stands tall is Lady Stiltman, because she's the best one.
No, and actually, I'm glad we brought up Whiplash, because as opposed to just being, like, another one, a reflection of Tony. In this movie, Ghost is not a reflection of either Wasp or Ant-Man. In fact, her power set is like in the same spectrum, but nothing at all like theirs.
Mm-hmm. She's, if anything, she's a reflection of Janet. If anything, really, like, there, and the fact that getting Janet out is the key to saving her is an interesting, it's an interesting idea and conceit that's used really well in the movie. Both to be something that brings awe, but also as something that's really stressful while you're watching it.
Oh, can I have another question with her backstory? Yeah. So we get her version and we get kind of Hank's mini version. But since they went to Argentina, I assume that her dad was working with Hydra because of the connection Argentina has with Nazis.
Oh, weird.
I mean, here's the thing. I don't think... So there are a lot of people who were working for S.H.I.E.L.D. who probably didn't know that they were working for Hydra. I would say that that's probably true. And he probably was getting help from Hydra without actually knowing it.
But to me, the fact that he went specifically to Argentina in like a historical sense makes it seem to me that he went and was working, even if unknowingly, with Hydra.
Most likely. Definitely. Yeah. Yeah, probably. I think that's fair.
Yeah, I just wanted to bring that up before I forgot.
Yeah, no, that's an interesting thing to point out.
Can we?
And I wouldn't be surprised if we found out that Ghost, most of her missions were probably Hydra related. That's why Fury wasn't like, put her in the Avengers, or anything like that. Like,
or she's if in the future, if like her and Winter Soldier run into each other and they like know each other from like a mission.
Yeah,
would be fucking cool.
Yeah, probably.
Or they teamed up.
Yeah. Yeah, because there's no reason. She would have been incredibly useful when they were trying to get to the cosmic cube and it was trapped in a weird field or whatever. Pretty helpful at that moment.
I just want to know if we could talk about the Stan Lee cameo. Oh,
I was actually going to bring that up. That is probably my favorite Stan Lee cameo in a long time.
Just remind me what it was.
He goes to get into his car and he's got his key.
Oh, yeah.
And then they shrink his car, and it goes, well, the 60s were fun, but now I'm paying for them.
People actually...
Okay, okay. Can someone explain that joke to me? Is it because...
It's
because
he created both these characters in the 60s.
Well, no.
But, it's, like, is it that he was like, oh, like, I'm old and on drugs and...
No, he was on acid in the 60s.
Yeah, did a lot of acid in the 60s, so now he's paying for it. He's losing his mind.
Yeah, there's a big kind of theory that, like, you can have if you did acid, it builds up in your spine, you can randomly, at some point later on, get, like, a flashback of acid, and you just...
Okay. Yeah, because I saw that, and I'm, like, also, like, not one for, like... Like, I think, like, Stan Lee cameos are, like, cute, but, like, I can kind of, like, take them or leave them.
They're ubiquitous at this point. Like, they're not really special.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You're waiting for it, and then now we're just waiting for the one where it doesn't happen because it's dead.
I think the last time I liked the... brought it there. I think the last time I liked the Stan Lee cameo was, like, Deadpool 1, when he's, like, the DJ at the strip club.
Yeah,
it's just, I think it's just so out of place for him.
Actually, one of my favorites is from the first Amazing Spider-Man when he's the librarian with the headphones on and just like minding his own business while Spider-Man and Lizard are tearing up the library.
I have curiosity, what was his cameo in Infinity War? Like, was he like one of the people that
he was Peter's bus driver.
Oh yeah, that's right. I was gonna say he didn't have one, but no.
I do love his
cameo
in Age of Ultron though, because he's one of the drunk. He's like the drunk guy.
Who wants to drink Asgardian ale?
I think it's like a little like the end of that movie is like already like kind of really sad in Infinity War, but I think it's like if you really wanted to punch the audience in the face, like if Stan Lee cameo happened and then he got dusted, it's like
that's too real.
I also like the fact that in this film we got two generations of Ant-Man and Wasp.
Yes. Yep.
I didn't think Pym would suit up at all, ever.
His suit was
yeah.
It was. It reminded me of like a bulkier version of the Adam suit.
I was about to say it looks like Adam's suit from Legends, and that's his suit's actually pretty cool looking.
It also looks a lot like the comics version.
Yeah,
also.
It's weird that it was it wasn't smooth. It was like different geometrical shapes. I don't know how to describe it. It was like
it kind of like the chest kind of juts out a little bit. Right. It's like a bulky piece of armor.
Yeah, it's definitely more armor-like and metallic.
But then again, if I'm at that age and I'm deciding to go do something that's extremely dangerous and reckless, yeah, please put me in a big giant titanium suit that's gonna keep me safe.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Can and I'm also like not one to like usually be like, oh, like like this lady's like so hot, but like Michelle Pfeiffer is still like a total babe,
dude. Michelle Pfeiffer.
Yeah, no, you're correct.
Timeless.
I wouldn't be surprised if they said that her in the opening scene, if that's like a Kurt Russell thing, where they really just had to reduce the wrinkles a little bit, because, damn.
They didn't even have to go with Kurt Russell, with Lawrence Fishburne in this movie.
They were using clips from Boys in the Hood there. I could tell you what movie that they were using.
Well, like, I'm looking it up right now, and they use his son as the stand-in for young version of him.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's definitely his face on there.
But no, in Kurt Russell and Guardians 2, most of that is not CG.
No.
Yeah. Most of that is just lighting and makeup.
Most of that is just Kurt Russell being an immortal being.
Yeah. Well, mm-hmm. It also connects to them, what they basically said for Captain Marvel, is that they're basically going to have Samuel Jackson mm-hmm. and, what's his name, the place, Coulson.
Clark Gregg.
Well,
Clark
Sam Gregg. Jackson is ageless, so that's not that hard. Yeah. Like... And also, like, if you think about it, the 90s is kind of his not his peak, but, like,
I mean, that's where we were introduced to him.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
San Andreas? Wait, was he even in San Andreas?
Yes,
he's the, like, the main corrupt cop in San Andreas.
No, Arlen's thinking about the movie, San Andreas.
Sam Jackson's been around since the 80s. He was in goddamn Goodfellas.
Yeah.
Well, he was, but he wasn't, like... Nobody knew who he was when he played the guy who gets shot getting his coffee or whatever. But no, like, 90s is, like, when everybody knew his name and he was in literally every other movie for, like,
the 90s
5 years.
Where he was an A-lister.
Mm-hmm.
The 2000s is where he stopped giving a fuck and just wants to do money, which is...
Well, yeah, that would explain the spirit so much.
I mean...
There's a lot of things to explain the spirit.
That is one of my favorite bad movies.
I've heard a story.
What was that, John?
Have you guys done like an episode like talking about the spirit?
No, and
you
I am
need to.
I'm chomping at the bit to do it because that movie is so fucking funny.
It's so ridiculous.
Who the hell? Who in their right mind was like, yeah, give Frank Miller a camera. He knows what he's doing.
Yeah, he, you know, it's like, he did pretty good by, like, RoboCop 3. Like, give it to him.
RoboCop 3 wasn't him, that was RoboCop 2. But, yeah.
No, RoboCop 3 was him.
Are you sure?
I would put money on it.
Well, we have internet, so we can Google.
I hope you're wrong, that's the thing. Because I know he did RoboCop 2, for sure, but I didn't know he did 3.
Directed by Fred Decker, screenplay by Frank Miller.
Ooh.
Oh, wow, okay. Well, yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if things changed heavily, because Fred Decker directed Monster Squad, which is what makes RoboCop 3 fascinating.
What do we think of all the side players in this? I think everybody actually has something. Well, except for what's his face, the rapper who is in the right. Yes.
I actually thought that I wished we got more T.I. because I liked him so much. I liked him a lot in the first one.
I loved all the ex-con security crew stuff. Like when they were explaining Ghost, and the one guy's like, and he's like, oh, yeah, like Baba Yaga. And like, and they explain like who Baba Yaga is, and it plays as like the setup for a joke like 35 minutes later where Ghost shows up, scares the shit out of everyone, and like leaves.
Well, yeah, it was that part. That guy's like in a ton of stuff. He's a great character.
Yeah.
But like, that's that whole thing. He's talking. You just see like, everyone's face turned like, well, that is really creepy as shit. But I did think that they barely used T.I.
He does have one of my favorite lines, though. It's when Louis starts talking, and they're like, can you please shut up? And T.I. goes, man, you put a quarter in him, you get to hear the whole song.
Playing
the whole song, and then he starts telling the story about the Bronx with his mom.
So I'm looking up like that one guy, and I guess he was Abracadabra in the Flash.
Yes, he was in
the Dark Knight, the second one.
Yeah, he's the crazy dude who Harvey's gonna like
shoot and
take out. Yeah.
He's all over the place. He was not bad in the Flash. However, he's unfortunately an accessory to the Savitar reveal, so that character can burn.
And the setup of DeVoe.
Abracadabra is like low key like one of my favorite Flash villains, so that's kind of disappointing.
He was pretty cool. Yeah. The whole episode, he's kind of ahead of everybody until the very last moment.
Because Abracadabra
should have been the season 4 villain.
Abracadabra is a man from the future. He uses future tech to pretend to be a magician in modern day.
Yeah. So he's Booster Gold, except he wants to be a magician instead of a superhero.
Yes, and that's why it's so good.
And the thing with him and the fucking Flash season is that at that point in the season, pretty much everybody was like, tell us who Savitar is. And then we're like, all right, here we come. He's going to tell us. And he's like, I'll never tell. And then gets taken back.
No, he's the mustache curly villain ever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyways, no, he's good in this movie, but you're right, T.I. does not get nearly as much, and he got, like, some of the best jokes in the first movie.
Well, he does the whole scene where he, like, sets the car alarm off in the first one. He does a bunch of stuff. I
didn't know before I sat down to watch this that Walton Goggins was even in it.
It's so good.
I knew he was in it. I actually was surprised at how little his role was.
Yeah, but he makes a lot out of a little.
Like, it was good. Like, I was like, oh, I don't want him to be another bad guy industrialist. And, like, mm-hmm. I was kind of glad that he was almost comedy for the most part.
What's the matter? You don't want another Aldrich Killian?
Well, like, I love how, again, with Ghost, like, how, he, like, anytime Ghost shows up, we're just like, what the fuck is going on?
I like Aldrich Killian, so.
Oh, damn!
Because I actually really love Iron Man 3.
Okay. I don't hate Iron Man 3 at all.
I don't hate Iron Man 3 either, but this goes back to a thing of like, fuck Ike. Because of him, what the fuck is her name?
Rebecca
Hall. She was supposed to be the Mandarin in that movie.
What's her name? Maya.
Maya Hansen. She was going to be the Mandarin.
It's supposed to be Hassan.
Yeah, but guess what? According to Ike Perlmutter, female toys for villains don't sell at all, according to him, because he's an expert on these things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was very candid about that, too.
Well, she's barely in the movie.
And good for her, and then she's just unceremoniously dropped off the film.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they, like, kill her. She's in, like, 3 scenes in the whole movie.
And she dies. Doesn't she die in like a gruesome way, like shot in the stomach or whatever?
Blast her in like the gut.
Yeah.
I actually recently watched that movie because FX was running it a lot. Probably.
FX had a whole Marvel movie marathon on G4, so we were just coming in and kind of just watching parts of different movies.
I think they did a marathon as well before Avengers released. War release, because I remember like there was just like all the Iron Mans were on. I was like, I haven't seen 3 in a while.
So I think we should probably mosey towards the end of the movie. They get Janet out of the quantum realm, and from what everybody's telling us from Marvel's end, like the quantum realm is like the next big thing.
Well, I don't know if you guys thought, but when I saw the quantum realm. Quantum Realm again compared to like the short part we saw in the first one, I was like, ooh, this is directly looks like the Doctor Strange shit. Like
it does
so similar. I was like, good, I'm glad that they kept that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it looks even more like when Peter saw his mom vision or whatever. It looks even closer to that looking at it again.
Who saw their mom?
When Peter sees his mom
Peter
in
Quill.
The yeah
okay you just said Peter yeah. And I was like, well, there's Parker, there's Quill.
My Peter is Peter Quill, so thank you. But no, yeah, like when he sees his mom in that weird Guardians or
Take My Hand. Mm-hmm. The Quantum Realm is probably going to be the thing that enables time travel in Avengers 4.
Oh, Michelle Pfeiffer basically says it.
Yeah, which means that, like, fucking Ant-Man is going to be the dude who shows up to save the day.
Right. Okay, so can we go to the post-credit scene? Yeah, because
basically, if he's stuck there, like, she basically says if you're stuck there for a significant time, it changes your physiology, which means because she cures ghosts. So what... Yeah, like, you're making him, like, the key to everything?
Yeah, because I'm guessing he's going to be, like, existing in multiple times. Like, he's going to be... I don't think there's a character like him, really. Like, he's just going to exist throughout time as, like, an echo, I guess, if he's there too long. But Michelle Pfeiffer says something about, be careful or you'll get stuck... Or you'll get sucked into a time vortex, and you don't want to do that.
Yeah, there's like a bunch of like, kind of what do you call it? That they say during the thing, because they also explain that like it connects different universes.
Mm-hmm.
So like, did he just not get affected by the snap because he's there, or was he just not part of that?
He's outside of reality. I read because he's outside of reality.
He's not,
you know, even from Thanos' grasp with the gauntlet, he's out of his reach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's why everybody gets turned into dust that's important to him. I was
expecting Wasp, wasn't expecting all three of them.
I thought that it would be him and Hope.
And that's what I thought too.
So we would get the Ant-Man and Wasp, but with him with the character that he barely knows.
Yeah. Yeah, that was something I thought would be interesting, but I guess, like, he's just gonna have to... I think he's gonna look for one of those time vortexes, I guess, and, like, I don't know where he's gonna end up, but it will be interesting. Maybe he ends up in the future?
I do know... That's... I knew he was gonna survive because I think some, like, leaked concept art came out, or something came out recently, and he's...
Oh, we've seen set photos.
Well, yeah.
I've seen set photos.
I don't look for set.
Oh yeah, we there. Yeah, trust me.
We've seen set photos. He survives, but it's just like it's the how that's more interesting to me than anything.
I guess it's like if we're like talking about like the post-credits sequence. I think it's like, I think it's like a little weird that like this is the first Marvel film with like a female lead like in the title of the film, and then the post cred sequence is like, oh yeah, we're gonna ghost her, and it's like,
yeah,
I thought about that too,
and it just seems like a little weird that it's like that it is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I think when you're like you're dealing with it, like a character's actions like Thanos, like on the scale of it, it just comes down to like, I think it would probably just come down to flipping coins at the end of the day. Like, well, this person goes. Like, what? Like, creatively, I understood Infinity War because they left the original six plus a few guests to have one last hurrah. But this, I don't know how to explain this.
I would say that they were going for ultimate heart wrenching. It's like, oh, we just reunited this family. They're all dead.
Also, putting Scott in the worst possible situation. Like, nobody, aside from the people that have been dusted, is in a worse situation than him at the moment.
But it's like, is everyone, not just like, even if he was the only one and he wasn't in the quantum realm, everybody he cares about is gone. Like, for the other characters, we don't necessarily know that, and they at least have each other, but he's so not connected to anyone. Like, even Spider-Man or Iron Man... is connected, like they're all connected to each other. He's like very.
I would say his only other pal is like Falcon.
Falcon,
right?
Kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's a very good point. Like he doesn't have the same connections to the rest of the Avengers
as we're talking about. Like him and Cap and Ant-Man are like on like a pal basis.
They're best friends. He calls him Cap.
Yeah, he calls him Cap.
Me and Cap, Captain America.
You and Cap, huh? You call him Cap?
If only Cap could see you now.
The one other character I really want to talk about that we haven't yet is Jimmy Woo. Like, yeah, Jimmy Woo is great.
Oh, yeah, he's awesome.
All the supporting actors, like the henchman who's like, it's not truth serum.
Oh, yeah. it's not truth serum.
But, so good. But I think like a lot of like Jimmy Woo's character is like, you know, it's just like, it's like that kind of like Stockholm syndrome thing where it's like he's spent so much time with Scott that they're friends and he wants to bust him, but like I feel like he secretly doesn't. And then there's like that like very end when he like he loses his ankle bracelet and he's like a free man, and like he thinks that Scott's asking him out to dinner, but he's not.
Oh my god, that was
awesome. Did you want to go out to dinner? Did you want to?
Like, I'm free. Have you guys ever watched anything that he's in, like Fresh Off the Boat? Or...
I have a little bit. Yeah, yeah,
he is a very funny comedian, and he's a I know he's like among the main writers on that show.
Mm-hmm. He's funny in everything he's ever been in. Like, he's funny in Neighbors, like as like a guy at a college fair. Like, he's just one of those great supporting comedic actors.
Apparently he's been in a bunch of stuff I've seen, but I don't remember him from anything.
He's in the Jason Segel movie with Emma. Oh god damn, what's it called? It's like getting married. Vision is in it.
Oh, five-year engagement.
Cameron Diaz.
No, it's not Cameron Diaz. No, it's no. What's her name? That's British.
I'm looking at it right now.
Emily Blunt.
Emily Blunt.
It's a 5-year engagement.
John has it open in front of him.
Okay, so we were looking at. Okay, so he's been in two Jason Segel movies, because I'm looking at him in that movie Sex Tape with Cameron Diaz, where it's a giant Apple commercial.
No, that movie that I forgot exists.
That movie's really bad.
He's also in Aquaman.
What?
Holy shit.
He plays a character named Dr. Steven Shin.
Oh, that's actually a big character in Aquaman lore.
Damn.
He's like the Earth expert of Atlantis. If you watch the Aquaman, what was the cartoon movie that they did?
Throne of Atlantis.
Uh-huh. Yeah, he gets off like really early in that movie.
Hmm.
But he's like a stalker kind of UFO guy, but with Atlantis.
But also, I'm looking at this right now. Randall Park, he played Kim Jong-un in...
Holy...
Yes, he did.
Yes, he did!
In the interview.
He's actually Korean.
Right. But yeah, we all forgot about the interview, which is 4 years ago now. Holy fucking shit.
The movie that got Spider-Man into the MCU.
Yeah, it did, technically, and we learned a lot of things from those emails. We're still learning things.
Yes.
Those emails are like, in summation, Steve Buscemi with the skateboard going like, "What's up, fellow youngsters?"
Also, like, Lawrence Fishburne as Bill Foster is really good, to the point that, like, I really kind of wanted to see him become Goliath in that movie.
Yeah.
Oh, me too. I was begging for it.
I don't know like where you would fit him in, but I was just like, like almost like you're like slowly kind of setting up an almost like 70s like a like post or like pre Avengers Shield team of like Hank Pym and Bill Foster and Janet. The Wasp.
Yeah.
And
I've pitched this before.
I would
love it as well. Like
Peggy Carter.
And yeah, Peggy's the leader. Like, there's your leader. That's your Captain America of the 70s. Like, yeah.
And they all face off against the Winter Soldier.
Yep. I was gonna say they all figure out that Kurt Russell's on Earth and they're trying to get him off. The ego.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of different meanings to what you just said that you might want to re-examine, Lou. But yeah,
Lou's like, I know what I said.
I know what I said. That hair is its own. It gets its own credit.
God damn it. But no, I mean, that's a little bit early for them to be going after him. But yeah, no, that's an interesting way to do it. Winter Soldier just makes sense because what he does can be so small that it wouldn't be, like, known to everyone. But it's still, like, a big deal if he, like, kills someone. So, yeah.
But I was really glad that he was not just, like, a one scene, that one scene in his office.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm glad that we didn't get like a Perry White with him, where he's just, like, a scene and then he's gone.
Right.
Oh, you mean where he's a man who's losing his mind over the course of 2 hours?
Yeah. Well, because we only see him in that trailer for that one scene, I was like, he's probably a bad guy, most likely, an antagonist.
Just, like, a useless cameo, just to be like, oh, here's a Goliath, mm-hmm. and we got a good actor, because he just makes these movies for his grandkids.
He's also like a giant nerd, apparently. So. Yeah. Yeah. Although,
don't Google Lawrence Fishburne's children.
No, do not Google his
daughter.
Daughter?
Yes
daughter. His daughter.
Why?
Yeah. You should look it up, John, because
I know what you're talking about. Never mind. I got
Whoa, hold up. What the fuck?
Do we want to do this? Because I can do this.
I'm going to do it right now.
One that's weird is she looks like Lawrence Fishburne.
That's true. That's another part of it. It's like, if you want to see Lawrence Fishburne basically doing things, like, Apocalypse Now, Lawrence Fishburne, though. Like,
yes.
So, yeah.
But in, like, bad rap videos that aren't really rap videos, they just have music, but they're actually on websites.
Right. Yes.
They're those weird, like, kind of rap videos, but they're not really rap videos.
Wait a minute. She became a porn star?
Yeah. Oh,
well, star is a big word.
Look, the
pornographic actress.
Look, the porn ceiling is pretty low. Anyone can be a star.
Technically, I believe she said she's, like, a music video, like, a rap video vixen, but these are the rap videos that are, like, on WorldStar. In, like,
oh, right, man.
Find them not blurred out.
I think I'm good.
Anyways.
You gotta use incognito mode.
We have a VPN.
It's not for you. It's for, like, people if something happens to you and they need to search your history on your computer when you're not there.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's very good in the film. Furious Styles coming back in that CG thing. He was well used, I think, in the movie. And again, neither him or Ghost come off as, like, villains. They're more antagonists than anything.
The whole conversation he has with Ghost about, like, the daughter, about Cassie, is great. Mm-hmm. Where he's like, if you touch her, I'm done. I walk away.
Yeah. Yeah, he has a line.
And then the end scene where she's like, go, like, you haven't done anything wrong. Like you said, I've hurt people. And he's like, I'm not mm-hmm. leaving you. And she's like, I was like, oh, please don't make this weird. And then it was like, oh, no, it's kind of like a father-daughter.
Yeah. Well, I think what's interesting is that they could easily do a movie, just give her a movie. And I would be there opening day, like I am for all these Marvel movies, because she's a very compelling character.
I really want Thunderbolts.
No, she should be in Budapest.
That would be interesting if they do that, though.
Because she's age-wise, like, if she was, like, it's her first mission.
Yeah, again, like, I get the feeling that she wasn't, like, not everybody knew about her. Again, Nick Fury would have called her in, I feel like. Like,
I would think she's too unstable.
Maybe, but this was, like, the height of S.H.I.E.L.D. before they fell.
You have to go into what part of S.H.I.E.L.D. is she working for?
Right, again, like, that goes to my point of, like, I think she was working for Hydra unknowingly.
That's what I think as well.
I think you're spot on with her parents were probably working for Hydra without knowing it, and so was she, if I had to guess.
Well, even if you make it that they did know it, it's like, not that she's a little kid, she doesn't know anything.
Right. Well, also, like, I don't think her mother would be okay with knowing that they were working for Hydra.
If you look at the other movies, there are members of Hydra. In Sitwell.
Yeah, I know, but still, like, Sitwell's different, I guess.
Yeah, but, like, there's some, like, leeway there.
Mm-hmm. Still, I don't know. But then you go, like, well, the woman in the polka dot dress, and then I go, well, that's the TV show, and it doesn't count. But still, like, it's iffy, because they do a lot to make it seem like Hydra in the movies that they aren't Nazis. And I think that's a problem.
They are.
But they do a lot to suggest that they aren't, and I don't think that they should.
I think even in the books, they get weird with it, where it's like, they started there, but were they really started there, or did they start earlier than that, and they get into the whole, like...
Because I think it's like they want their cake and eat it too, where it's like they want them to be like these really disgusting villains that you want to see taken down, but then it's like, oh, we also have to like merchandise everything, so it's like to sell a bunch of shirts. And we can't really have, like, Nazis on our shirts and sell them to people.
It's also an easy way to make, like, oh, they're bad guys, they were Nazis. Like, it's like, you don't have to explain more. And then as, like, kind of we go down the eras, it's like, well, we wanted to kind of do more with them, make them more inclusive so they can have, like, hidden members.
Well, it's harder to sell a book called Bob, Agent of Hydra, if Hydra is just, like, straight up a Nazi organization. Like, it's harder to say, to do that with a straight face.
Team characters are part of Hydra.
Side tangent, did anyone read the new Ta-Nehisi Coates Captain America book?
I have not yet.
I'm waiting for a trade, but I do intend to pick it up.
Not super spoilery at this point, but, like, a weird, like, I wonder where this is going kind of thing is that, like, one of the people that helped, and this honestly could have been something that happened in Secret Empire, and I just didn't hear about it.
Right.
I didn't read that book outside the first issue. Is that, like, one of the people that helped take down the Hydra Empire was Baron Wolfgang von Strucker? And so he's, like, kind of, like, regaled as a hero?
Interesting. Wow.
Oh. Aren't all the Struckers?
I did not know about that. Yeah.
Well, Strucker is dead in the MCU.
They killed, depending on how attached S.H.I.E.L.D. is, I think they killed his kid in one of the S.H.I.E.L.D. seasons.
Interesting.
I did not know that.
Yeah, one of the seasons, getting his kid, there's like a bunch
Strucker was in the Marvel movies. I completely forgot about that.
He's in Ultron for like 3 seconds.
Yeah. Oh god, I'm so sad about that because I was like so excited about seeing the Satan Claw on the big screen.
His son,
and then he gets off screen.
Yeah.
His son and that other Hydra guy that's with him are in like that entire whatever season that was. They were in S.H.I.E.L.D. Are in like that entire season.
Swordmaster.
No, the, like, kind of Arab Indian guy. I don't remember his name. Because, like, the half of the season of, like, that season of S.H.I.E.L.D. is that they're trying to get Strucker's kid because he's kind of, like, the heir apparent to Hydra. Because of blood lineage.
Huh.
Because, like, the incestuous Strucker twins are in, like, The Gifted. But they're not incestuous.
Oh, well, thank God for that.
Yeah.
Well, my favorite is when, like, the girl dies and then he makes his, like, the thing.
His sword in... Yeah.
Yeah, it's her skin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Comics are fun.
Yeah. Indeed. Yeah, they are.
Do we have any final thoughts on that, man? Maybe keep it a short one?
The very last thing I want to talk about in the movie is like the post credit sequence. Like you talked about how this movie had like your favorite like Stan Lee cameo possibly. This movie probably has my favorite like post credit sequence of any Marvel movie, where it's just a shot of Scott's apartment and you just hear like static on the TV and it's like post Infinity War and all you see is just Anthony like playing the drums.
That is me, Anthony died in the first.
Well, okay.
I'm being
Ulysses
like,
S. Grant. but like,
so
but it's
Antonio
like the,
Banderas.
Yeah, but it's like the idea that it's like you have like this really funny scene of this ant playing the drums, which was like in the trailer, by the way. And I was just like kind of waiting for that scene to happen, and it just never does. And I'm like, oh, it's like one of those scenes that they play for the trailer, and it just never happens. But like juxtaposed to like this really dark, somber like downturn, and it's just like. Yep. Oh, like, shit just got real.
Mm-hmm.
It is a very grim sequence because it's just like, isn't it just an emergency broadcast?
Yeah.
I thought it would be so great if they played that the leak thing from CNN that Ted Turner had made for the end of the world.
the end of the world tape.
Did you, besides Arlen, do any of you guys know what we're talking about?
No.
I have no idea.
Oh, no, so Ted Turner was like, well, Ted Turner's a evangelical Christian, so like he believes in the end of the world. Yeah, that on top of that, it's like, so when the world ends, TBS and TNT are going to play a tape celebrating our finest moments, but it was made in the 80s, so it's our finest moments up until then, and it's amazing. Yes. You need to see it.
Someone, because it's TNT, TBS, and CNN that he owns, mm-hmm. and it's like the anthem, and then it's like American flag, and then like some pictures of like big events in history, and then it's just the anthem, and then it just like fades to black.
But it's children playing the anthem,
yeah,
like a school marching band.
It's so goddamn weird. And someone at CNN leaked back in like the early 2000s.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not okay with any of that.
Yeah, and if you watch it, it's all VHS quality. Like,
yeah. It's been like, yeah. It got made in like the mid 80s.
Mm-hmm. It's really good. I think we can do we need to do a State of the Universe? Because not much has changed. It's just back up to where we were at the end of the last one. Sort of.
Half of everyone is dead. There you go.
Yeah. The next movie is Captain Marvel, right?
Yes.
So that's going to be the thing that... This is more of like a side quest on mm-hmm. the main plot. A side story. If you were doing like a big crossover, this is like the one-off of like Ant-Man during mm-hmm. the big crossover event. So while Captain Marvel is going to be the continuation of the plot.
Mm-hmm.
Have they announced like it takes place in the 90s, but have they given like a year?
I think they said 1995. I think that they made that.
We know is that there's Coulson, Fury, what's his name from the Kree?
Ronan.
Ronan the Accuser.
Ronan and his second in command robot brain guy.
I super love Ronan the Accuser, so like I'm glad to see some more of him back.
I did find mm-hmm. his character interesting in that movie, so to make him a religious zealot. So it'll be mm-hmm. interesting to see if he is that in this, or if he becomes that at the end of this movie.
Well, it would be interesting if he's like 70s Osama bin Laden. He's just like a goofy guy, like who dresses kind of weird, but like he's not a villain yet. That would be interesting, I guess.
That movie finish? That movie wrapped like real recently, right?
I think it's still shooting, but you might not be wrong.
I can't remember because like either that is close to wrapping or Daredevil season 3 just wrapped. Like a bunch of stuff is like coming to a close.
Season 3 did just wrap. That is a thing that I was like, watching a thing with Charlie Cox early today. Yeah, so
Jessica Jones is like halfway done filming.
Really?
Yeah. They've already started there. Like season 3 is coming out mid next year probably.
It was the episode that she was directing that Ritter was directing. Some photos leaked, and one of them I posted on a group on the Phantom Zone of pictures of Patsy.
That's right, yeah.
Which I do not know what you do with her to like redeem her.
They'll try.
Because she's pretty despicable by the end of that series, and I.
Oh, I disagree.
This is true.
I think that she's.
She makes some very bad decisions.
Oh, no, she makes a bad decision, but the end decision she does, she's the only one that has the balls to do.
Okay,
but that doesn't make her. But that doesn't make her like good. Like
no.
The point of that season is that no one's good.
I agree, and I understand from her point of view. It's like, Jess will never do this, but like it doesn't make it your choice then when it's your, especially when it's your best friend. Maybe leave it up to somebody else. I might be wrong, but you know, whatever. I don't know if there's anything to say to the universe other than what we already brought up, which is like they confirmed a lot of our theories about how they're gonna get out of this. The time travel is gonna play a part.
I think Ant-Man's going to be like one half of like the main thing that solves everything.
Mm-hmm.
Which would be cool, because it's like the biggest threat, the answer is the smallest, like, you know, character.
Connor, remind me of something.
There's a way better tagline in somewhere in there. Just give me about 5 minutes.
Connor,
answer
to the biggest question is the smallest thing.
Refresh me on something. Did we hear rumors that they recreated the cave sequence from Iron Man 1? Or is that something that I'm misremembering?
I don't remember us talking about it, that's for sure.
I think they recreated the New York sequence, for sure.
Yeah, but I just have a distinct memory, but I want to make sure that I'm not just, like, going crazy and, like, making that up.
I do love the idea of, like, if at the end of everything in the next Avengers that Scott Lang saves everything, but he's just kind of, like, the big dick in the group, where he's like, all you guys, goddamn Thor, Captain America, Iron Man, and Scott Lang, who... You didn't even remember my name when you saw me in prison.
Yeah.
Like, he's the guy that saves the universe. It would be hilarious.
That'll be interesting. But I think my point is, like, how weird would it be if they opened Infinity War Part 2 with the beginning of Iron Man? Like...
It would be awesome.
That would be crazy. I don't know if they'll do it, but I think that would be an interesting place to start from. And then Marvel logo comes up and... You know, but Ant-Man is there. That was my point.
The one thing I thought that would be hilarious, which would be like the ultimate fuck you to DC, is if they have Hawkeye fire an arrow that Adam is or the Ant-Man is on.
Okay.
To kill Thanos.
So, I thought about, like, because the reason I asked earlier about, like, when the movie takes place is, like, in 1995. Because I was like, oh, man, like, I wonder what, like, the soundtrack's going to look like. Because I really like how the movie Iron Man 3 is in 1999 and opens up with Eiffel 55. It's, like, perfect. So I'm like, oh, man, what big song in 1995 can be featured in Captain Marvel? And I just happened to look at the top 100 of 1995, and number 4 is "Kiss from a Rose" by Seal.
Oh shit!
How funny would it be if "Kiss from a Rose" was in Captain Marvel?
Well, I mean, to go even further, what if they pass by a TV and Batman Forever is playing?
Oh my god! I'm looking at the top 100 songs, and they're goddamn hilarious. The number one song of 1995 is Coolio's Gangsta Paradise.
Which it should be, because that song is awesome.
Okay, no, that song is going to be in the movie.
Yes.
That song is 100% in the movie.
Which Michelle Pfeiffer was the star of.
Yeah. Wow. I'm looking at this list now, too. Some of these are definitely going to be in there.
Like, I want that one Collective Soul song from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Whoa, oh, I can tell you one song that's going to be on it, which is Runaround by Blues Travelers.
Oh, my God.
It's a perfect song. Oh, no. I found it.
Stop it.
No, number 18. Bombastic in the Summertime by Shaggy.
I was looking at that, too. That's
1,000%. I saw Shaggy this past summer, or during, like, a couple months ago.
Shaggy's still alive?
Yes, he's on tour with Sting.
Like, Sting from the Police?
Yes, they did an album together.
Whoa. Oh, it did. Michael Jackson's Scream came out. Is that going to be in there?
Number 19 was Total Eclipse of the Heart.
This is not the original one. This is the very definition of a tailspin.
Hold My Hand by Hootie and the Blowfish.
I support it, though. So.
There has to be like a Vegas betting list of like, what popular 90s song is going to show up in Captain Marvel?
You know, it's going to definitely be in there because they own the rights because it's Disney. Colors of the Wind. Because this is the year of Pocahontas.
Interesting. Anyways, I think I do think this is.
I am fading very badly. So.
I am on jet lag on several beers and just like anger at the Royal Air Force of England.
Oh my god.
Okay, yes. Then.
Anyway.
Fuck that damn England and the Queen.
All right, well, I have been Connor McGraw. Check out Movie Dumpster. We have Mosquito coming out in a few days, probably. That was an absolute blast. It is an absolute dog shit movie, but it's a fantastic dog shit movie, and I think everyone needs to own it.
Lost Horror Podcast every single week. Episode coming out this Friday is Mission Impossible 1 and 2, because we are reviewing the movies leading up to the next one. And we're going to review that one when it comes out. So look forward to that, and see you next time, guys.
Okay, do you want to go, John, or do you want me to go?
Go ahead.
So Smallville Chronicles, the newest episode dropped this morning, which was Shimmer, where a man or a teenage boy rubbed invisible stuff on him and tried to choke out a naked woman while he was naked.
Excuse me?
Yeah. This is 2001 when, like, that stuff can happen. Oh, and this reminds me of the next episode, which we'll be recording tomorrow. The reason why me and Alan were talking about Ink, the X-Men, was because the next episode, a bunch of football players get tattoos with kryptonite ink, and they give them super strength.
Oh my god. I remember now why I stopped watching Smallville.
I remember now why I never started.
We don't have access to aliens yet, but we need people with superpowers.
Yeah. Yo, dog, what if instead of just having iconic Superman villains, we had, like, really bad villains of the week?
You say that, but the Wasp...
We're kind of copies.
The next episode we're recording features the Wasp. This is one of, like, six episodes where she is a extra.
Damn.
I'm John Sieler. I work for Faku.net, so if you are 18 plus, maybe check that out. You can also find me at Twitter at John_FN_Sieler. I'm not going into conventions for the next couple of weeks, so that's about
nice.
It.
Nice.
Alrighty, that all of us?
I think so.
Alrighty then. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye. Fuck X-Men up. Yeah.
Fuck the Queen of England.